So welcome to our first kind of official lecture here on our topic. And that is, we are going to begin this journey through ancient history, and we will look at, really, this is going to be human history, right? That the history of the Earth is much longer, and geologists will be happy to tell you about this, but historians largely delve in only the realm of human history. And specifically, historians deal really only with texts and the written word, and not so much material culture from prehistory. And when I say prehistory, I mean before history was written down, before we have any written records. And this is really what we call the Stone Age. And this is a time when man began developing from a primate, as the theory goes, in the plains of eastern Africa, some millions and millions of years ago. And anthropologists and paleontologists have theorized that humankind developed from primates, and this is the theory of evolution. And this is, of course, not to privilege only the theory of evolution, for there are many other billions of people on planet Earth who would argue strongly that there are theistic and religious explanations for the development of humankind. But for this class, we are going to specifically be looking at just really the more scientific explanation for this, but there are others. But the Stone Age, let's get into our topic here. And the Stone Age is where humankind begins to use stone tools for to help them live. And there are three periods within the Stone Age, and that is the Paleolithic, the Mesolithic, and Neolithic. Paleo meaning old, meso middle, and neo new. And this corresponds with various degrees of tool specialization, and when we began to see differences in the kinds of tools that humans are using. And then we define these various ages of prehistory based upon the kinds of tools that human beings are using, such as when humans began to develop bronze tools and weapons and such. This becomes then a transition from the Stone Age to the Bronze Age. Then around 1100, we began to see the use of iron in tools and weapons. So then this transforms from a Bronze Age to an Iron Age. And this is just how historians kind of neatly unpack these time periods. And one thing that is important when we think of prehistory is sort of the human condition. So what do human beings need to live? We are not capable of living independently without the help of various technologies, and what we need to survive are food, water, shelter, and protection. And this is usually done through living together and living in small communities, and humans begin as hunter-gatherers. And this means that they do not cultivate crops, that they do not have domesticated livestock, but they are hunting and gathering solely for their means of subsistence. That means you cannot have large communities because there are not food surpluses available, and it tends to be migratory, that people are nomadic. And we see this throughout early human cultures all over the world, that humans began to, as the theory goes, spread from Africa throughout the world, and therefore then develop independently in many years later. And these first humans, there were a group called Neanderthals, but really we will be looking at the Cro-Magnon, or the group that will become Homo sapien, or Homo sapien, which means wise man. And as human beings begin to develop, begin to live in larger communities, they began to develop what we call pastoralism, in that they domesticated various animals, cattle, horses, sheep, and were able to use those animals, of course, to subsist. We also began to see the beginnings of early burial practices and religion and objects that we believe that they were to be used as apotropaic devices, meaning that they would protect them against the natural elements, that the divine forces would intervene to help them, and that this was the beginnings of human religion. And we see here in this slide, we have a cave painting that is in the south of France that is estimated to be between 15 and 10,000 BC, and this is an example of some of the first human art that we have. So human beings begin to develop in ways that other creatures did not. They develop in societies, and they begin to create tools, and they begin to create art. And really, I want to say something about these migrations of people. We're not going to get into the Indo-European migrations here, but climate change often causes people to move around, and it is theorized, of course, that climate change pushed people or allowed people to move across the Great Plains of Asia, and eventually crossing the Bering Strait and into North America. And as the ice ages transformed the world, that then people became divided and lost touch with each other. And there is what I really want to discuss here is the agricultural revolution, and that is around the year 10,000 BC, and this allows human beings to stay in one place permanently. Before this, you had to continually move around because they would exhaust food sources. They had to move with animal migrations and such. But around the year 10,000 BC, we began to see in river valleys, especially in Mesopotamia, Egypt, India, China, that you began to start to see people planting crops. And the first cultivation of wheat begins really in Turkey. And we see that this allows human beings to generate agricultural surpluses, that they were able to domesticate animals, and they were able to plow fields, they were able to sow crops, they were able to have surpluses of food. And when you have surpluses of food, it allows for specialization within human cultures. And this specialization then allows people to become really good at their jobs. And you can be a plow maker. You don't have to do everything. You can specialize in whatever you are really, really good at. And this allows civilizations to develop. Humans can live in cities instead of having to live out in largely rural areas. So civilization develops because of this this agricultural surplus. So along with the specialization comes invention, that you can invent new technologies to do things better. And when you live in large groups in cities or in larger groups, you have to develop government. You have to develop rules and regulations for people to live together, because they tend to not get along and things don't work very well. You have to have someone who mediates these things. And then, of course, writing will come about. What are our first written records? Well, they are taxes, of course. And writing is such an important thing because it allows them to pass on, allows humans to pass on to posterity their wisdom, that you can then tell others how to do things, and you can communicate things in very highly complex meanings through writing. And commerce, of course, develops, meaning that you can trade with other peoples who have other things. So it allows for specialization on a much grander scale. So really, when you have the advent of writing, our oldest forms of writing are cuneiform tablets, as seen right here. And these forms of writing change from a pictographic, which means that they are a little symbol. So if you want to say there is a bird, you kind of draw a symbol that looks like a bird. And later we began to see the development of alphabetic writing, meaning like in our own language of English, you have A, B, C, D, E, F, G, and these symbols, these letters, and A, it has the sound of an ah, and it can then be used to communicate things. So instead of drawing a picture of a bird, I just simply spell out bird. Or now, for simple things, it's not that much of an advantage. But when I give you a more highly complex term like love, it would be much more difficult to communicate that through pictographic writing. But nevertheless, we began to finally see the development of writing around the year 3000 BC, and our earliest forms are, of course, cuneiform, which is in Mesopotamia, the land of the between the Tigris and Euphrates River in present-day Iraq. And about the same time, slightly after, we see writing beginning within Egypt, again another river valley, and Sanskrit in Egypt or in India. So all of this development happens independently, but human beings are developing independently, but they are sort of developing similar technologies around the same time. So this concludes our prehistory lecture, and I hope you have come to have some appreciation for the development of humankind, and I will see you next time.